This topic introduces the evolutionary mechanism of natural selection, which is perhaps the single most foundational principle in all of biology. But since we've been thinking about the nature of science, I'd like this also to develop some of these bigger ideas. For example, exploring the boundaries between where knowledge is scientific and where it isn't. Rather than starting you off with the obvious lesson on Darwin and the development of his explanation for evolutionary change via natural selection, I'm going to tell you about Georges Cuvier, a Frenchman who was well respected among academics of his time, though in the end, he really did not embody a way of thinking that could be called scientific. Cuvier studied many things, and he contributed to our growing body of knowledge in ways that you might call scientific, in the sense that they were based on careful observations of the natural world. The time frame here was in the last part of the 1700s. Charles Darwin was born in 1809, so this is well before Darwin's time. And we were just getting around to thinking carefully about fossils. They were mineral in composition, but they certainly bore generic resemblance to living organisms, though often not matching up specifically to any known living organism. It wasn't clear how to interpret these differences. Were fossils just some kind of inscrutable artifact produced during the act of creation, or were they actually telling us that different kinds of life had existed in the past? Cuvier did a lot of work with mammoth and mastodon fossils, and he established convincingly that these were different from African or Indian elephants. The only explanation for these fossils that he could offer were that they were indeed the remains of living organisms from the past, organisms that were now extinct, and in fact, extinction is a concept that comes from Cuvier's studies. Cuvier also did some work with a mining company that was active in the area around Paris, and digging these super deep holes in the ground is an activity that's obviously going to turn up a great number of fossils. By cataloging and classifying the fossils from Paris and analyzing the location and depths of where they were found, Cuvier established that Paris had once been under the sea. Actually, not just once, but at four separate times. His thinking works like this. Fossils of marine organisms were there in some of the deepest layers, so these would have had to have been the oldest. The sediments have to be deposited in order from bottom to the top, right? So the deeper you go, the older the sediments. This is the basic rule of superposition, and Cuvier was the one to establish this rule. So you have these marine fossils at the bottom in the area that's now Paris, and this tells you that Paris was under the sea at the time those fossils were deposited a long, long time ago. Then on top of the marine fossils, you have a layer with a lot of fossils of freshwater animals, and this tells you that after the saltwater fossils were deposited, the area was above sea level, like at the bottom of a lake. Paris is in a large flat basin, so it could have been a lake. And then on top of the freshwater fossils, there were marine fossils, telling us that the area was under the sea again at a time after it had been a freshwater lake. This sequence of alternating salt and freshwater fossils was correctly interpreted by Cuvier as the era having a history of being alternately under the sea and above the sea, a minimum of four times for the layers of sediments that Cuvier had available. What's more, changes in the early to late sequence showed that extinction had occurred between each event of submersion. The marine fossils in the oldest layer were replaced by different marine fossils the second time Paris was under the sea. The freshwater fossils were also replaced by new forms of life each time the area was a lake bed. If you're hearing this and thinking that Cuvier's findings suggest evolutionary change, this was not lost on other naturalists. Another Frenchman, in particular a guy named Jean-Baptiste de Lamarck, presented an evolutionary explanation for this replacement of old life with new life, and he did so publicly some 57 years before Darwin did. But realize that in the year 1802, the Bible was still considered the authoritative history of the universe, and it wasn't cool to suggest things that weren't there in the Holy Book. As strange as this may seem, Cuvier, the guy who showed the world that there were at least four massive flood-like extinction events, was a strong proponent of the Bible's historical validity. Yeah, the Bible only accounts for one flood, but according to Cuvier, this is because it's the only flood to occur since the creation event of Genesis. Cuvier explained the Paris fossil data, as well as the mammoths and mastodons, by saying there had been earlier creation events and extinction floods that simply predate the events of Genesis. Cuvier's model is called catastrophism, and in Cuvier's mind, this was the best possible explanation for fossils without contradicting the Bible. Meanwhile, on the English front, a different perspective of the Earth's history was taking shape. Charles Lyell, building on earlier work by James Hutton, was developing a model of geologic change in which gradual forces like erosion, deposition, and uplift were continually giving rise to canyons and mountains and other geologic features. This idea of uniformitarianism is the exact opposite of Cuvier's catastrophism, which runs more along the lines of animals getting created, and they stay that way until, bam, flood wipes everything out and we start over with the creation of somewhat different animals. By this way of thinking, the mountains would have to have been created, and then the canyons eroded during those massive flood events. Two very different explanations for the existence of mountains and canyons. The uniformitarian view says it's the accumulation of the work of gradual forces. Catastrophism says that it all happened in sudden events. So how do you decide which one to believe? Well, as we learned in an earlier lesson, the scientific way of dealing with this is by experimentation and allowing observations from the natural world to support one or the other model with evidence. Well, guess what? Catastrophism is supported by exactly no evidence, while the uniformitarian view is supported by lots. And okay, you saw that coming. Now, back to Lamarck, the French evolution guy. No, not French Revolution, French evolution, who suggested evolutionary change 60 years before Darwin. Nowadays, we don't give any credit at all to Lamarck for being the father of evolution, and this is because the mechanism that he proposed was just totally wrong. His idea was that organisms somehow passed on whatever improvements they made on themselves to their offspring. This doesn't happen, although much later on, when we talk about the human brain, we'll see how the spread of ideas by imitation and emulation gives us a dynamic that's very much like Lamarckian evolution. At the time, however, nobody knew whether or not Lamarck had the right evolutionary mechanism. Cuvier attacked Lamarck for a totally different reason. This is going to be a little deep, so put on your philosopher's hat. Both Lamarck and Cuvier knew that, in order for evolution to be true, it would require millions of years, whereas the Bible's chronology puts the Earth at around 6 to 10,000 years old. And this is simply not enough time for evolution to occur. Lamarck's answer was that the Earth is actually much older than what the Bible said. This is where Cuvier cries foul. Cuvier blasted Lamarck, saying that he was altering the Earth's history with only the justification that he needed to accommodate the time requirements for his theory of evolution. Lamarck was guilty of a posteriori reasoning. A posteriori means to the rear, and this is problematic because you're supposed to let the facts of the case drive the conclusion, right? You're not allowed to start with your conclusion and then make up the facts in a way that will make your conclusion true. Never mind that this is exactly what Cuvier did with his catastrophism model, but this isn't what I want to stress here. Now, if you paid careful enough attention in the scientific inquiry lesson, you should realize that when you're trying to explain something scientifically, there's going to be a little bit of a posteriori reasoning, because that's how the hypothesis gets made in the first place. But then very quickly, you get into activity that's not posterior at all, such as designing an experiment and making predictions, and this is what makes science a legitimate investigative enterprise. But Cuvier was stalwart in his opposition to Lamarck's view that the Earth was actually very old. Now it turns out that Lamarck was actually right about the Earth being older. Not just millions of years, but as it turns out, the Earth is 4.6 billion years old. Cuvier's judgment of Lamarck was based on his not having the appropriate justification for making the claim of the Earth being older. In the years following Cuvier's attack on Lamarck, this little shouting match became a totally moot historical footnote. The uniformitarian model for geologic change became fully established and became generally accepted, though never by Cuvier, that the Earth is much, much older than just a few thousand years. By the time Darwin proposed his evolutionary model, This particular objection could not be raised. Everyone knew that there was plenty of time for evolutionary change to occur. Darwin's idea that populations change by natural selection, and we'll be addressing this in the next couple of videos, propelled him to the status of scientific immortality for two basic reasons. One, it's incredibly powerful. This simple mechanism provides a naturalistic explanation for everything biological. As the great geneticist Theodosius Dobzhansky said, nothing in biology makes sense except in the light of evolution. Two, Darwin was, well, right in all the way that Lamarck was wrong. Similar to uniformitarianism, evolution by natural selection has a mountain of supporting evidence from observations and experimental results, and this is how it got elevated to the level of a scientific theory, which in science is the highest level of establishment that a scientific model can gain. It's just short of a natural law. Cuvier has been at the center of this discussion, and in thinking about Cuvier now, I'd like you to consider how conflicted of a person he must have been. On one hand, he was highly skilled at making observations from the natural world and interpreting them, and at the same time, he was never able to let go of his incorrect views in spite of a growing body of evidence supporting the opposing point of view. Science is about following the lead of evidence, not ideologies.